approaches from different industries, and most of the discussion led to usage of big data in different industries in their application. The last subject, but not the least one, is data science for financial and marketing application, led by Marko Bohanec. And the main topic of this discussion led to dominance in decision support systems, its complexity and simplicity, and the usage of comprehensive models in their application in industry. That would be it for today's session. I believe that most of you can gain some knowledge and some experience from this session, and we can continue on our coffee break.
Yeah, so we are kindly asking you now to move to the other room, and we're hoping that it was very well led and prepared, and that you generated a lot of new knowledge and new contacts and widened your network. Thank you very much.
Industrial research compared to academic research. Maybe some of the point here will be useful as hints for people, for younger people which want to involve in industrial research. And let's start. Since 2000, I'm teaching in Transylvania University of Brasov, Faculty of Mathematics of Informatics. Right now, I'm an associate professor at the same faculty. I'm teaching mainly artificial intelligence, machine learning, software architecture, and so on. 4 years ago, I also joined the Siemens Corporate Technology, a big multinational company. And I'm involved as a research engineer, mainly covering topics of machine learning in various internal projects or European-funded projects. As you all know, machine learning is right now quite a popular topic in in the area of computer science. And I wonder whether it's not too much emphasized from the press, and whether we should prepare for the next AI winter. I don't know. I'd like to know your opinion about this, because there are a lot of overemphasized results wrongly presented by the press. And the people have greater and greater expectation from machine learning. Indeed, there are some results which are proved as being useful for, adversarial games or computer vision or recommendation engine and so on. But it's still a long wait up to finding something that can work on its own. As a result of this, there are a lot of people which aim to join the machine learning movement. And here in the room, I saw not only computer science people, but also students from another specialties. Congratulations, and keep going. On the other hand, academia and this industrial environment should somehow help each other, but there are some large gaps between the two worlds, and I'm going to emphasize some of them. For example, in academic research in machine learning, people like to study some of the building block, basic building block, which are currently used in machine learning. For example, how should I polish the learning rate of specific algorithm? You know, Adagrad, Nesterov, and so on. Whether the saddle points is important or critical to be avoided or not. Or how should I combine various experts in ensemble model, sorry. And maybe some other advanced topics are when should I avoid some models in order to produce some good results? Not all the models are good, so when should I avoid some of them? For which one? For which type of data are they good? But this is actually rarely encountered in academic research. And overall, we are colleagues with a lot of highly creative people and smart people, but they have a low pressure of of producing pragmatic, useful result. Maybe it's just my understanding, but sometimes they are simply working in area which are only weakly connected to the real world. On the other hand, in industrial research, we have really, really tough questions. Some of the questions were already mentioned in the discussion today. And the big companies do not provide only big devices to the customer. They also provide smart services related to this. For example, one wants to perform a root cause analysis or predictive maintenance. When the device will break and what are the main causes of its breaking? Just to be able to come in time with a solution. Another hard constraint, which is rarely seen before joining the industrial research, is in order to deploy your solution, you have to take into account what the existing framework. So you have to deploy in form of plugins or other approaches, and you have to take this into account. Maybe this is a constraint to have to take into account. Okay, the most important part is there are a lot of domain experience here, and you have to somehow embed it into your application. And this is indeed an active research area in machine learning, but the results are quite poor. Plenty of data. Everyone asks for data. We have data in industry, no problem here. But there are actually dirty data. And in order to avoid the garbage in, garbage out syndrome, you have to carefully select the data which are used for machine learning. And last but not least, there are some non-disclosure agreements which had to be signed between the researcher and company, and it limits your visibility. So take this into account in order to join a company. Even the data set, the companies are very jealous with their data set, and they do not provide them for public benchmarking. How an academic research looks like. For example, there are some practical results speaking about different models and telling that the model, a specific model, put your favorite model here, is a universal approximator. And there are plenty of models which are actually a universal approximation, for example, multilayer perceptron, fuzzy art map, Bayesian art map, and max out, and so on. There's a long list of this type of universal approximation. What it's all about? This result tells that once you have a continuous function, you are able to approximate it by using the model M arbitrarily well. The trick to realize it, to show this, is to prove that the set of functions which can be produced by the model M is denser in the set of continuous functions defined unit hypercube. We'll see some detail on how to achieve it. It's actually much simpler than it looks. Myself, I have proved such a result. And after that, I will come with the critics about this type of result. It looks useful, but actually it's much less useful than it looks. How can one prove it universal approximation? First thing first. All remember, or should remember, the Weierstrass approximation theorem, which tells that a continuous function can be arbitrarily well approximated by a polynomial. This is an old result, and everyone is happy with this. Later on, the Stone-Weierstrass theorem said that it's not only about polynomials, which are good approximator, but you can also consider other different types of function which can arbitrarily well approximate continuous function. So in the next 1,000 slide, you can see a short proof of the Stone-Weierstrass demonstration. I'm kidding. This is the official statement of the Stone-Weierstrass theorem, and under some mild, very mild assumption, it is simple to prove that your set of functions, which the approximation model can compute, is actually dense in the set of continuous function defined over over X. So we simply like this this theorem because it's very easy to come up with some models which obeys the condition of this theorem. And generally, we are looking for such general and powerful mathematical result, and we hope to be able to understand them and to adapt to our learning model. Now, the critical part. Is it really important? Does it matter? This is a question which arises, which was asked by a reviewer, which said, nice, but is it really important? And this is a tough question. So what is the main drawback of this type of theorem? It looks nice, but actually it speaks only about the architecture of your model. It's not speaking about the learning method applied on that model. So you may have a good architecture, candidate architecture, but if the learning algorithm is dumb, you will lose everything. So universal approximation is quiet, should be rather related to the learning algorithm, not to the architecture of the model. Okay, and more than this, is something which is more interesting than universal approximation. Anyone knows about universal approximation, but it's something called best approximation, which says that model is a best approximator if it can find the minimum distance, the minimum possible distance to the function it is trying to approximate. There are plenty of universal approximated, but only some of them are actually also best approximator. This is also simple to prove. You can see Girossi and Poggio paper mentioned here. And we should also concentrate not only on universal approximation, we should go a step further. But actually, this is still a theoretical step, maybe not that useful. What is more useful from the practical point of view is the learning speed of the system, how fast it can adapt to the data. Think about the classical algorithm theories. We are stressing our student about complexity of the algorithm. Why is that important? From the same reason, stressing about the learning, the speed of adaptation of the system is also important because you see, you know, when you should stop bringing more data into a model because it will not change very much from this point onward. But on the other hand, universal approximation can be proved by an undergraduate student once he knows about the framework provided by Stone-Weierstrass theorem. On the other hand, in order to prove the speed of learning or to say something about the speed of learning, it takes a little more. For example, you have to know probability theory, statistics, and so on. This is shameless self-promotion, one of the results I have provided in another paper, telling how fast the weight WT of AI are approaching the probability to be estimated. And it's quite hard. I had to go into Martingale's theory in order to jump over the condition of independently and identically distributed. This is the main assumption for most probabilistic results. And in this case, I have to overcome this this part. And one has to study this Martingale theory or maybe another result in order to come up with an estimation of the speed of learning. This is what happened in academic world. It's nice. You get citation. It's okay, but quite useless, actually, from the practical point of view. This is my subjective point of view. You may agree or not, but I'd like to know your opinion about this. On the other hand, in industrial research, there are plenty of problems formulating like this. I have this problem and we fail to solve it. Can you solve it? For most of the guys in industry, machine learning is something magic which can solve by itself the problem. So it's the ultimate approach in which can solve their problem. And another question, it's a more difficult question. We follow this approach and we fail. And can you help us to solve them? It is much difficult because you have to be aware of the failed variant in order to avoid reproducing them, to reinvent the broken wheel. Other problem, which is unseen before joining the industry, we have some constraint to fulfill. It's mainly about computational resources. Some of the devices used for computation are small. So you cannot deploy an ensemble learn-based mechanism on it because this is this requires a lot of performance computing, computing performance. And you have a specific framework in mind, but you should adapt it in order to be able to deploy it. Otherwise, it's completely useless. Another requirement, which sounds scary in my opinion, is we want to get the human out of the loop. Right now, a lot of engineers are staring to monitor showing the activity of turbine. For example, in Siemens we have a lot of turbine, and trying to spot out the difference from the normal behavior. They want to reduce the number of engineers and to replace them with automatical method. What should you consider if you join as a freshman or researcher, mature researcher, when you join to industrial research? There are now not such a well-defined problem in industry as you find in mathematics or computer science. So you have to seek for the problem because this is ill-defined. Also, an idea which was stated today. After the engineers finish their trials on the problem at hand, what remains is actually hard because they eliminated all candidate cases, all candidate method which could solve the problem. So you are coming after a lot of failure of engineering approaches. Okay. Some of the details, more than this, some of the details are not communicated from the first meeting. So you may start dream about some hypotheses, but actually they didn't happen. They don't happen. You have to elaborate something in conjunction with the guys. There is a cultural gap. Imagine that a guy explains you about the difference between two shaft turbines and one shaft turbine. Not funny all the time. And most of the time, the engineers lack the machine learning understanding, so they don't know that you really need data, you really need to make a model assessment or a model choice, and it takes time and you need a lot of data. Okay. More than this, there are also a lot of over-engineering approach, which are equivalent to overtraining, overfitting in machine learning. But simply, not all the time the engineer realizes it. So it's hard to translate an experience from one point to another. Okay, the problem are really ill-posed. For example, the engineer say that we want to predict the activity of a specific device, but this is quite hard actually because you want to predict what? When it will crash, why will it crash, the most likely cause of the crash, and so on and so on. The four traditional hot topics in industrial engineering is descriptive analysis, what happened. Actually, it seems simple, summaries, reports, and so on, but you have to grab a lot of data from a lot of distributed logs and to join them and to come up with an overview of what happened. Root cause analysis is actually the most important part in industry. Why did it happen? Why did the turbine trip? And so on. What is the most likely piece of turbine which will crash? Predictive analytic, what will happen? Because if you know that the turbine will trip, you can schedule a maintenance stop and to call the maintenance engineer and so on, and to avoid some unpleasant moment with explaining to the customer it happened, but we wasn't aware about this. And prescriptive analytic, which actually is about optimization of and having a proactive attitude, is what should I do in order to avoid the problem. Unlike academic research, you have to work in interdisciplinary term. You can master the stone wire truss theorem on your own, but you are unable to understand how a medical device, a complex medical device, behaves and why it crashes. And the next bullet is, in my opinion, the most important part. You know that all machine learning models have their own inductive bias. And if you have a predictive model which is biasless, then it is completely useless. So you have to know a lot of models from machine learning, but also their weaknesses and their weak part in order to avoid them for specific cases. It might seem obvious, but you should, for prototyping, you should start to learn Python, Weka, NIME, R. I already saw some of you involved in this part. MATLAB, Octave, if you know MATLAB, the engineer will love you because MATLAB is very popular among engineers. Deep Learning 4J, it allows you to produce deep learning models on the Java platform and so on. Then you should quickly be able to extract, transform, and load the data. You have 4 hours in order to come up with smart question for the customer, and in the next 4 hours you will have in-depth discussion with him why it happened and why should avoid how to avoid the data. For example, we found that two sensors which measure the temperature on a specific device had higher than 10 Celsius degree difference. And we asked the user what to do and why it happened. He came up with a very complex explanation. And finally, we agreed to proceed in a specific way. But otherwise, computing the average of two values and one of them being outlier, it's actually a bad idea. Also, you are using a lot of tools, but the tools are not perfect. For example, if you are using Octave, you are downloading Octave from the internet, you can find that the actual Octave version is compiled for 32-bit version. So it doesn't allow for many data loaded inside. Or Excel can handle about 1 million lines and so on. So you cannot load large CSV files inside it. Okay, and more than this, again, nothing in the academic world. There are some implementation details. Even for the very simple naive base, there are actually 5 models which are discussed in the paper shown on the screen. And it's very frustrating because naive base is very popular. It has zero or less or small number of hyperparameters, so actually people love to use it. In the same area, backpropagation. In the previous century, we have 65 version defined for backpropagation. So just telling I use it backpropagation for this problem was actually is actually not enough. Okay, we have a problem with reproducibility. One guy before told about this, but we have a problem with reproducibility of result in industry, which is more critical here. For example, we had to ask a guy for the sources, the MATLAB sources of his system, in order to find out that the description in an IEEE article is actually much simpler than the actual implementation. It happens. What you should consider here, outlier detection. Forget about two class or n class classification. This is very unlikely to be encountered in industry actually, from my experience. You have only a set of data showing normal behavior of something, and you have to define somehow how to spot the abnormal cases. Only based on normal. You don't have two classes, you have only one class of data. Concept drifting, it's not only about drifting of the data, but it's also about drifting of the sensor. Some sensors simply get too old for the task at hand, especially the sensors measuring high temperature or high vibration and so on. So you should take into account how you compensate for the drifting in the sensor and when to stop looking at that sensor because the data is completely messy. My favorite, incremental or like trim learning, is the same thing. For example, in the Internet of Things, you have devices which acquire a stream of data, yet they cannot store the data for later usage, and you have to learn by hand, learn incrementally. Okay, so just be able to learn, continuously learn, without forgetting what you have learned before. Adaptive resonance theory is a very useful tool here. Also, data fusion. Tomorrow we'll have an in-depth discussion about data fusion, as far as I know, and this is a very critical part. How do you melt a lot of data information without having the problem with cars of dimensionality? Explaining the model. You don't convince an engineer that simply because of statistical evidence, your model correctly predicts something. Actually, he will ask to you, show me that you show me somewhere in the technical documentation that indeed happens like you said. And this is a tough question. Metric learning. Everyone is in love with Euclidean metric, but actually this is a bad choice because some of the features are more important than others, so you have to learn them. For a computer science student, some advices I'd like to be aware of a few years ago. For example, start learning linear algebra, but also cover singular value decomposition, another hot topic, because right now people is interested in how to make value decomposition on tensor, not only on ordinary metric. Probability theory and so on. Learn to program, of course. In order to produce fast code and to test your ideas, Python, MATLAB, Octave, avoid C, C++, C sharp and so on because they are too verbose for fast testing. One idea found in Kaggle Winner interview, file fast and recover. Be able to replace some of the building blocks you are using and to come up with another idea. Don't spend 5 weeks in order to find that it's not working. Learn distributing the environment, this is obvious. And one final remark which came from different industrial partners, become a machine learning project contributor. Join a project story, don't care, GitHub or something they like, try to promote yourself by activity. This is the most important thing for a student. What did I learn? This is the last slide. Industry asks for end-to-end solution. Okay, by yourself, you are not able to provide an end-to-end solution, but you have to be able to communicate with the guy which provide you the data and to communicate with the guys which take the resolution from your predictive model. Take into account that existing software architecture are not appropriate for the task at hand, okay? So you should start to learn about PubSub, architecture or complex event processing, for example, take into account Microsoft Streaming Site or better Spare in order to make a complex event processing. Without it, you have to do a lot of manual work and this is tedious and error prone. When you have some problems at the customer, present everything which doesn't work and allow him to be involved in the decision, in the final decision. And finally, you should be aware about the technical environment for rapid prototyping. Okay. Just the final point. I don't know whether in Belgrade is or in Serbia is a common, but there are plenty of trials to create data science laboratories and by collaborating industry and faculty. I'd like to hear about this, whether you have some cases, and this is the bridge which can close the gap, you can lower the gap between industry and the academic world, in my opinion. Thank you.
Okay, thank you again. Now we have time for a few questions. Does anyone have a question? Zoran? Okay, I wanted to... No, you're not ready. You're not finished. So you told about this mathematical results that you think that they are useless. Let me ask you like this. Do you think they're useless right now or they will be useless for all times? So are they useless just for the moment for the industry, or will these some of the mathematical results will be maybe useful in, I don't know, 100 years?
Well, I think they can be expanded. I think that this type of result can be expanded for industry, and it's really useful from what I did is.